Singapore's parliament voted in favour of a motion that recognises rising cost of living as a global concern and calls for policies that ease the pressures affecting Singaporeans. It came after a marathon debate over an initial motion filed by the opposition Workers' Party, who labelled rising cost of living as a crisis. The ruling PAP pushed back with an amendment to ensure that any proposals wouldn't undermine the country's fiscal sustainability and burden future generations. The amendment was rejected by opposition MPs, and it led to over 7 hours of exchange between both sides of the House over policies affecting water pricing, car and home ownership, healthcare and income. At one point, the opposition accused the government of conducting policies based on seeking profits, an accusation that the ruling party rejected.
Acting Transport Minister Chi Hong Tat is urging the country's opposition party to look at broader and long-term fiscal threats facing the nation. Mr. Chi was responding to a motion filed by the Workers' Party, which called for policy reviews in areas such as income, utilities and healthcare. He adds that while the nation has had a good financial year, it is not spending less than what it receives in taxes.
We don't have a structural surplus. Our fiscal expenditures have been rising steadily and will continue to increase. And we are almost certain to face a funding gap in the coming years if we do nothing about it. MOF had published an occasional paper earlier this year to highlight this trend. We are expecting more social spending in healthcare for our aging population and to better support vulnerable groups in Singapore.
Mr. Chi says Singapore needs to stay competitive in creating jobs to sustain real income growth. He says that's as real income fell in the early half of this year, even though nominal income rose slightly.
But our experience in Singapore is that so long as our economy grows and remains competitive, real income can continue increasing for a broad segment of our workers. In the long run, the key to sustaining real wage growth is to raise productivity and upgrade the skills of our workforce to take on better jobs with higher pay.
Restructuring water tariff tiers was among proposals by the Workers' Party. Leader of the opposition, Pritam Singh, says that this is so that household water usage is reflected more accurately. Mr. Singh suggests that bills could be reduced for those who conserve water as well.
This should be coupled with a graduated water conservation tax regime starting at 30% so that households that consume more water cross-subsidise those that consume less. A graduated water conservation tax across the various tiers would incentivise water conservation and continue to serve the policy purpose of ensuring that water is continually treated as a scarce commodity.
Mr. Singh adds that some Singaporeans are facing what he calls a cost of living crisis. The other proposals include a shift in weightage of the workfare income supplement to give low-income workers a bigger cash payout. He also suggests allowing seniors with healthy Medisave balances to use the money beyond what is allowed today. And meanwhile, People's Action Party MP Liang Eng-hua proposed amendments to the motion. He adds that governments shouldn't adopt extreme approaches that undermine its fiscal sustainability, but instead pursue policies that are responsible to future generations.
We need to be able to always have the means to pay for this cost, which is rising in our current situations. Just because we freeze prices or put a cap to the price, to price increases, the outflow required to pay for this external cost doesn't just disappear magically.
Workers' Party MP Sylvia Lim also proposed a tier pricing structure for electricity use. It'll see households that consume electricity below a certain threshold charged at a lower rate. And on the healthcare front, Workers' Party MP Dennis Tan called for the government to relook its means testing criteria for subsidies, which currently looks at per capita household income. This is so that the specific needs of different households are considered.
For example, Mr. A is in his early 60s and working part-time due to his health condition. He lives with two other higher-earning siblings. They share common household expenses, but not individual medical expenses. The household income would be a key consideration, but the amount of subsidy he's entitled under the current PCHI formula. In a case like this, does the government expect Mr. A to reach out to his sibling to ask them to share his medical expenses?
Well, meanwhile, nominated MP Mark Lee says that the word crisis shouldn't be used to describe the cost of living situation here, as it implies that existing policies have faltered. He suggests that policymaking can be refined through more collaboration between the government and trade associations.
Our approach is a commitment to thoughtful policy making, avoiding quick fixes that cause more problems than they solve. Policies must be carefully calibrated to encourage growth and increase earnings without inadvertently sacrificing the future of our children, increasing the national debt or taxes in a way that could worsen living costs, driving talents and investments away.
Well, Labour MP Yeo-Wan Ling says having flexible work arrangements for caregivers and women returning to the workforce will help relieve financial stresses for families through adding an extra channel of income. She's urging companies to redesign work hours or locations around the time availability of such workers.
The labour movement supports our companies with the upskilling of their workers and the redesign of jobs so that more pockets of workers, such as caregivers, women returners, can partake in the workforce and alleviate income pressures at home. Instead of price cuts and passing on of costs to just another stakeholder upstream or downstream, flexible work arrangements can solve financial stresses for Singaporean families by adding an additional channel of income and help companies with resources and productivity.
Acting Transport Minister Chee Hong Tat says that the government takes into consideration fiscal sustainability and its social impact in policy formulation. This came as a response to non-constituency Member of Parliament Leong Man Wai's claim that the government's approach is to ensure that public services are profit-seeking.
I think the way the government conduct policies today, a lot is profit-seeking and using the market model. So I think what we are, as the alternative parties, what we are bringing to the House is that we hear a lot of feedback about problems. So the anger must be, besides using the market model completely, there must be more consideration for the social aspects of a lot of the policies.
I just spent good 40, 45 minutes explaining our approach to helping Singaporeans cope with the rising cost of living, and what we are doing through different ways in a fair, effective and sustainable manner. Now, we can debate about different ideas. We can discuss different possibilities, like what the Leader of Opposition and I have done just now on water. That is okay, sir. But I reject what Mr. Leong has said, that the government is profit-seeking.
Mr. Leong was asked to withdraw his comment that the government is profit-seeking. He refused to withdraw his comments. Acting Transport Minister Chee Hong Tat rejected his accusation, citing an example of how the government continues keeping buses running even though the routes aren't profitable.
Even when the bus service is not making money, we know this is a public good. This is a public service. It's an essential service. We continue to run that service, even though it is not making money. And then to make sure that we are able to run this on a sustained basis, the government then provides the subsidies to the tune of $1 billion for bus and $1 billion for MRT. So, sir, we are looking for financially and fiscally sustainable outcomes. It is different from profit-seeking.
The National Development Ministry will continue prioritising building flats for home ownership instead of for rent. Senior Minister of State Sim Ann says this is what Singaporeans still want, especially those in the middle income group. Meanwhile, HDB will still ensure there are public rental options for those unable to own a home. She was responding to opposition MP Louis Chua, who suggested increasing the supply of flats, both for purchase and for rent.
Why are we contracting new rental flats at a pace which is at a mere 10% of that in the past decade? To minimise the agonising wait for an allocation of a rental flat and to alleviate the worries of many Singaporeans who have not been able to access a rental flat, it is imperative that we do not neglect the housing needs of vulnerable Singaporeans in our pursuit of home ownership as the acceptable housing model in Singapore.
Let's listen to what younger Singaporeans want. MND and HDB have been engaging Singaporeans at large, but also younger home buyers or prospective home buyers, and most of the younger Singaporeans we have engaged indicated a preference to own their own homes, own rather than rent.
Amidst some ads, it's important to run public housing with financial sustainability in mind. This will continue to be critical when new models of building HDB flats in desirable locations are introduced. She was responding to non-constituency member of parliament, Leong Man Wai.
The HDB recently reported a $5.38 billion deficit. A lot of this is probably due to the subsidies given to the BTO buyers, because HDB pay $5.9 billion to SLA at the same time, in the same year. So I have two questions. Will this deficit, $5.38 billion, ultimately be paid by the Singaporean taxpayer? And two, when the plus and prime flex come into operations, will this deficit actually go up higher?
The answer is yes, these deficits are taxpayer funded. That's why, much as we would like to be as generous as we can, we also need to be responsible, we need to be good stewards of public resources, and we have to run the public housing building program with sustainability in mind. Now, as to whether or not with the prime and plus going forward, whether there will be more subsidies, I think that is not something that we can determine just simply by the introduction of the framework alone, but the intention of the framework is to streamline demand. Streamline demand so that people would make quite prudent choices, and it will emphasize the principle of owner occupation. And what I can say to Mr. Leong is that the subsidies will be very well used.
Leader of the Opposition, Pritam Singh, disagreed with amendments made by members of parliament. He adds that the Workers' Party has made several concrete proposals and urges the government to conduct a policy review to better support Singaporeans.
Some of these proposals by the Workers' Party will be revenue neutral. Others will result in increased expenditures. The Workers' Party believes that we should continue to look beyond short-term relief in addressing this cost of living crisis and to relook at prevailing orthodoxies on other schemes so as to lower costs for Singaporeans and their families.
The amendments to the motion included acknowledging that cost of living is a global concern and called on the government to continue pursuing policies to lower these pressures on Singaporeans. Mr. Singh said that this differs from the original motion, which asked for a review of current policies. All opposition members in Parliament stood to demonstrate their dissent.